Edwin Starr recorded his now famous version in 1970. Edwin Starr recorded his now famous version of the song War. While it reached 37 on the Australian charts, it reached number one on the USA Billboard Hot 100. And the song lyrics go on to say these things. It ain't nothing but a heartbreaker. War, friend only to the undertaker. Peace, love and understanding. Tell me, is there no place for them today? They say we must fight to keep our freedom. But Lord knows there's got to be a better way. Well, according to the United Nations, we are experiencing the highest number of violent conflicts in the world since the Second World War. And it begs the question, is there actually a better way? And what side does God take when there is a war? Let me pray. Jesus, as we take some time to delve into your word, as we look at the news and we grapple with what we see at times, and we see the way people behave towards one another, the way we war against others, Lord, help us to see your heart in this and how you would call us to respond. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, today we wrap up the last of our three-week series looking at You Asked For It. And thanks, Lorraine, for your question about does God take sides in war? Thanks a lot for that. I should have given that one to Samantha or someone else, but anyway. However, to answer this question, we need to understand the concept of war from a biblical narrative perspective. So I'm going to take some time to set a bit of a framework to respond to this question. And first, I need to say, we're not going to be able to cover it all today. We just don't have enough time, even though we will take a little bit more time than normal to do this. And as a follower of Jesus, my response is based on the teaching of Jesus, based within the context of what the Bible talks about, which I believe was inspired by God the Holy Spirit. My approach is also not to place myself over and in authority over the Bible, but to hold the Bible in authority over me with humility, including the stuff that I struggle with, and recognizing that I am not God. I don't have all the answers, and I also need to be cautious about passing judgment on some of the stuff that is written just because I don't like it. For example, keeping of slaves. While I disagree with the keeping of slaves, I need to appreciate that in a time that where this was happening and when it was commonplace, the Bible speaks about the treatment of slaves in the context of that time and that place and calling for a better treatment of slaves. And so when it comes to war, I struggle with some of the stuff in the Bible. We read with a sense of grandeur, Psalm 139. You made all my delicate inner parts. How precious are your thoughts about me, O God. And then we violently swerve around verses 19 to 22 before we return to verses 23 and 24 because it just has us feel that little bit uncomfortable. Or that in 1 Kings chapter 10, it acknowledges that Solomon was making money as a heavy arms dealer. That's part of the way he gathered his wealth, was in the dealing of weapons of war. In the New Living Translation, war is mentioned some 206 times and spans from the first book in Genesis all the way right up to the very last book in Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 to 16, with the writer named Faithful and True, referring to Jesus, God the Son, who judges fairly and wages a righteous war. Probably a few thousand years before Genesis 14, archaeological evidence shows that there was times of transition that were happening in the ancient civilizations from being a nomadic culture or nomadic people to agricultural societies. And warfare progressed on small-scale clashes through to massacres, often based around the control of fertile land and crops. Also, in present-day Germany, some 7,000 years ago, they reckon, there is evidence of torture being used before killing their victims. But in returning to the Bible, the first reference of war is in Genesis 14, where Abram's nephew Lot is inadvertently caught up in a war between feuding kings, and Lot and his household are taken prisoners of war. With some allies, Abram and his 318 trained men, trained already as warriors, rescued Lot and the other captives. So within the context of the day, Abraham had already trained up some of his men as warriors because of the potential of conflict happening. But their goal was not to plunder and to take land, but rather they were sent in as a rescue mission. On this occasion, in Genesis 14, Melchizedek, the king of Salem, the priest of God Most High, blesses Abraham with this blessing. In Genesis 14, 19 to 20. Blessed be Abram by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who has defeated your enemies for you. And as we move through the Old Testament, we have an increasing prevalence of war as the Hebrew people move from captivity with the Egyptians within the Egyptian nation, to what is often referred to as the Promised Land. And when they navigate through to that point, as we saw in the kids' video about Jericho. And as they transition from nomadic to agrarian society, this involved waging of war with those who were already living in the land. With a divine imperative, these holy wars were seen as sanctioned by Yahweh God. On occasions, the Bible talks about destroying the Amalekites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, the Hivites, the Jebusites, and not imitating their evil practices. In Exodus 23, verses 27 to 31, we read, I will send my terror ahead of you to create panic among all the peoples whose lands you invade. I will make all your enemies turn and run. I will send terror ahead of you to drive out the Hivites, the Canaanites, the Hittites. But I will not drive them out in a single year, because the land would become desolate and wild animals would multiply and threaten you. I'll drive them out little at a time, until your population has increased enough to take possession of the land. And I will fix your boundaries from the Red Sea to the Mediterranean Sea, and from the eastern wilderness to the Euphrates River. And I will hand over to you the people now living in the land, and you will drive them out ahead of you. Reading through the books of Joshua and Judges, there are at times gruesome details of killing that could be described in more recent terms, such as ethnic cleansing and genocide, the latter of which was only recognized as a crime by the UN in 1946. Throughout the Old Testament, Israel's breaking of the covenant with Yahweh God, their bad treatment of vulnerable people, and their failure to keep the Sabbath, as David Bone looked at last week, resulted in the Bible describing God raising up other nations to wage war against Judah and Israel to punish his people because of their disobedience. And then you jump forward some 400 years to Jesus' day, when the people of Israel look forward to the coming of the Messiah, who would restore Israel to its former glory under David and Solomon, to overthrow the Roman Empire that occupied the land of Israel and subjected the Jewish people to Roman authority, to bring in, to usher in the day of the Lord. But instead, what we find is that there is a shift in the New Testament language. Post-Jesus, we see a more passive stance in the physical aspects of war, with a greater emphasis of waging war in the spiritual realm. The most explicit passage of this is in the Apostle Paul's writings in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 12, where Paul writes this, "A final word, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to stand firm against all strategies of the devil. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places." So what happened to waging war against the Roman Empire and inaugurating the day of the Lord, where God would re-establish Israel to its former glory? Did God change which side of war he was on? In the coming of God the Son, the Rescuer. In Jesus, we see a peeling back of the layers to the essence of what true war was raging, and how, and only how, it would be truly won once and for all. So is God at war? Absolutely. In Isaiah 14, verses 12 to 14, we read this, "Now you are fallen from heaven, O shining star, son of the morning. You have been thrown down to earth, you who destroyed the nations of the world. For you said to yourself, I will ascend to heaven and set my throne above God's stars. I will preside on the mountain of the gods far away to the north. I will climb to the highest heavens and be like the Most High." Evil. At the very heart of evil is the desire to exercise power and to depose God. We know that evil comes in a variety of forms and is known by a variety of names. Lucifer, the Satan, the adversary, the devil, the accuser or slanderer. But the temptation that evil puts out there is at the root of Isaiah 14, and it's the desire for power. Evil promises us power, tempts us with the promise of gaining power, and is prepared to use death to achieve its purposes. We see this in the manifestations of war in humanity in Genesis 3, 4, and 5, where we read the story of the promise of power that only leads to death. "You won't die," the serpent replied to the woman. "God knows that your eyes will be open as soon as you eat, and you will be like God." You will have power like God. You will know like God. You will know both good and evil. The promise of evil is power, that you will be like God. You can depose God and be your own God. You will have knowledge and power at your disposal. Rather than living in shalom with wholeness, completeness within themselves, peace with creation, peace with each other, peace with God, evil promised that through power you can depose God and you can be your own God. Towards the end of the Bible, the same evil promise is given, the same one that we find in Genesis 3, and it's identified in 1 John 2:15 and 16, where in the New Living Translation it describes it as this: Do not love this world nor the things it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. For the world offers only a craving for the physical pleasure, a craving for everything we see, and a pride in our achievements and possessions. These are not from the Father, but are from this world. The power of cravings that can never be quenched, and evil's promise of power through your own personal achievements and in the gaining of possessions. Individuals and rulers of countries are seduced by power. Power over land, power over water, resources, oil, minerals, and with it war is waged against other nations and against creation itself. And individuals and countries will use death to gain power. And it's with evil that Jesus wages war and does battle to overpower evil in the most subversive of ways, and in so doing, achieves the ultimate victory. We pick up this account from the life of Jesus in Luke chapter 4, verses 1 to 13, where the battle lines are drawn once again, and evil comes out with the promise of power, this time to Jesus. On Jesus' terms, you can have power. Don't worry about God the Father. You can do it all yourself. Then Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan River. He was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where he was tempted by the devil for 40 days. Jesus ate nothing all that time and became very hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become a loaf of bread." Come on, Jesus. Why suffer needlessly? You're going to get fed eventually. Use your power now. After all, you're God, aren't you? Why wait? Then the devil took Jesus up to and revealed to him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment in time. "I will give you all these kingdoms and authority over them," the devil said, "and I'll give it all to you if you will worship me." Come on, Jesus. You want to be God over these kingdoms and use your position of authority? Use your power to depose God the Father, and this can all be yours. You can rule the way that you always wanted to see these nations be ruled. Then the devil took him to Jerusalem, to the highest point in the temple, and said, "If you are the Son of God, jump. Show me your power. It's there. It's coursing through your veins. Come on, show me what you've got." When the devil had finished tempting Jesus, he left him until the next opportunity came. We read about another opportunity in Mark 8, 31 to 37, where evil's promise of power is whispered by Satan through Peter's lips. No, Jesus, ushering in the day of the Lord doesn't come through your death. Use your power to wage war and to overthrow the systems and the structures of the Roman Empire. Establish the kingdom of God through your power over human authority. You won't have to die if you do it that way. But Jesus drains evil of its power and its false promises by not giving in to it, by not using his power on his own terms, but instead through the discipline of resistance. And then on the cross, Jesus demonstrates the ultimate power over death. Not by demonstrating his power in coming down off the cross, as evil once again promised, but by dying on the cross, innocent of any wrongdoings, but taking the punishment for the acts of human evil, and then raising to life again, demonstrating an ultimate power over evil and death. And Jesus lived, died, and rose again to bring about a progressive restoration of shalom, of peace. Peace, wholeness, completeness within ourselves. Peace within creation. Peace with each other. But ultimately, peace with God. Every act of healing that Jesus did was an act of bringing about shalom peace. Every resistance to temptation, to use power by force, to force my will on others, is an act of shalom restoration. The passage that Amy read earlier from Isaiah 2 verses 1 to 4 declares that God's desire is to see the restoration of shalom, wholeness and peace. So what do we do with the Old Testament passages about war, and how do we respond to war today? Well, some argue that when we look at the Old Testament, was just and righteous and holy, and that wars in the Old Testament were sanctioned by God, and they serve as a justification for war today. It's the what they call the dirty hands argument. Sometimes to prevent greater harm, you need to get your hands dirty. Some people will use the term just war as a concept proposed by St. Augustine in the 4th and 5th centuries and was developed later on. God will be on your side in a war when it is just. And so they go through a whole list of different ways that you check off whether it is a just war. Just war must be initiated by a legitimate authority, when there is a just cause, when there is the right intent, and when there is the likelihood of success, and when the ends justify the means, and only as a last resort. In the act of war, there needs to be proportionality of tactics for the objectives. There needs to be discrimination. Care needs to be taken to protect the lives of innocent people and their properties, the property of civilians. Following the war, a just war, order must be maintained and established with justice and restitution, where appropriate, and conciliation, so that previous aggressors can work towards a shared future of non-violence. So we use either war as an argument in the Old Testament as a justification for enacting war. We look at war on just terms and say only in these conditions should we even consider it. Or another response is pacifism, with passages like Matthew 5 as being key. That God is not on the side of war, and as we see lived out in Jesus. In Jesus we see someone who seeks the sinner rather than seeks to slay the sinner. Some Christian pacifists choose to ignore Old Testament references to war and only focus on Jesus and the New Testament as their arguments for opposing war. Other Christian pacifists take a different approach. They see that the Old Testament is a human portrayal of God. It's us painting a picture of what God is like from our perspective, rather than a God-given self-portrait. Therefore, biblical references that in the Old Testament that justify or are used to justify war as holy or as divinely appointed are a distortion. And we need to differentiate between the textual and the actual God. That if there's parts of the Bible that refer to war being holy, then that's just not from God. And we need to dismiss it. And that's the way some Christian pacifists treat it. But for me, there's a danger in this. if we dismiss the parts of the Bible that we don't like, and if you dismiss the parts of the Bible that you don't like, and we all dismiss the parts of the Bible that we don't like, whatever reason we don't like them, then we can end up with an impotent Jesus who is a nice guy and did some pretty fancy party tricks. And I think we need a God that is more than that. So what do we do? Well, where have I landed with this as I've looked at this a little bit? For now, and I'm open to see my perspective change on this, this isn't a concrete answer. But for now, the way I hold these accounts of war in the Old Testament is kind of like the way I hold the references to animal sacrifice in the Old Testament. And I hold both of those in tension within the broader accounts of the Bible. You see, people concerned about the killing of animals will struggle with the celebration of animal sacrifices in the Old Testament. People against war will struggle with the use of war by the Hebrew people. And as I look at both, I see God who works within human history and within the limitations and the processes of cultures of those times. But in so doing, calls for a better approach because there are consequences with these systems and behaviours. We see those consequences played out for King David. King David was a man of war. And God said to David, because of the blood on your hands, you are not the one to build my temple. You've got way too much blood on your hands. That will go to your son, Solomon. God constantly calls people to demonstrate justice to the powerless and foreigners, to be a positive witness of righteous living to the surrounding nations, and to care for people and creation and Sabbath rest. In Jeremiah 29, we read about how Jeremiah says to those held in captives in a foreign land, pray for your captors. Pray for those that imprison you, that have taken you as prisoners of war. Pray for the peace and the prosperity of the country that has taken you as captives. Because if it goes well for them, it will go well for you. Rather than fighting and railing against them, pray for peace. Pray and work towards shalom. Both war and sacrifice were allowed in the Old Testament, but they were never the goal or a preferred way to live. They were a part of a progression of redemption history leading up to Jesus, who would be the ultimate victor over evil and against evil by not giving into the promise of evil, that you can have power and you can be your own God. You can depose the true living God from your life. But through active resistance against evil and becoming the ultimate sacrifice, Jesus demonstrates a way of overcoming evil and living a life of restoring shalom, peace. So when we live today in such a way that we want to get our elbows out and use our power to get our way over others, we're on the wrong side of God's war against evil. We're being tricked by evil's promises that using power to get what you want will lead to a better life. We war against someone else to get our own way. I see the same seductive promise of evil accepted by some protesters today. Some protesters who protest against wars overseas and their abuses of power against other nations, where countries and states that want to have their own way at the cost of others and will use their power to force their will on others. But when I see protesters giving in to evil's promise of power by spray painting, smashing, abusing, using foul language, bullying, intimidating, and even to the point of coercive control. Because evil has promised to them that when they use power, they will get what they want, little realizing that it's only evil that wins, and that war and death and destruction are evil's tools. If only there was a better way. If only there was some wisdom that we could tap into, that we could draw from as Christians for an alternative response. Well, James, Jesus' brother, offers such wisdom to us as Christians that speaks about the desire for power that lies at the heart of war, and instead to seek shalom, peace. In James chapter 4, verses 1 to 10, James writes to a group of Christians that are experiencing persecution, that are experiencing tough times. And he says to them, "What causes the quarrels and fights among you? Don't they come from evil desires that war within you? You want what you don't have, so you scheme and kill to get it. You are jealous of what others have, but you can't get it, so you figure you fight and wage war to take it away from them. Yet you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it. And even when you ask, you don't get it because your motives are all wrong. You only want what will give you pleasure. You adulterers, don't you realize that friendship with the world makes you an enemy of God? I say it again, if you want to be a friend of the world, you will make yourself an enemy of God. Do you think the scriptures have no meaning? They say that God is passionate, that the spirit he has placed within us should be faithful to him, and he gives grace generously. As the scriptures say, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So instead, live subversive lives. Live lives of difference. Live lives looking to restore shalom, peace. Humble yourselves before God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come close to God, and God will come close to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, for your loyalty is divided between God and the world. Let there be tears for what you have done. Let there be sorrow and deep grief. Let there be sadness instead of laughter and gloom instead of joy. Humble yourselves before God, and he will lift you up in honor." Does God take sides in war? Yeah, he does. But not in the way that we imagine. God is waging war against evil. Evil's promise of power, he wages war against it by not giving into it. But then Jesus died in our place because of the consequence of giving into evil, our giving into evil. Jesus lived, died, and rose again to bring about restoration of shalom, of peace. And he invites us to be a part of that. Let me pray. Jesus, when we hear the accounts that there are more wars and conflicts in the world today, something like 110 different conflicts going on right now, we recognize that there is just such a hunger and thirst for power, and that people will use death and destruction to exercise their power over others to get what they want. And we see how far we've fallen. So far have we fallen from the shalom peace that you want us to experience. Help us to be people that will seek out and advocate for shalom, peace, restoration of broken, restoring of tattered lives. That we can be people that honour you with the way that we resist evil and the promise of power and using power to get what we want. Help us to be more like you. Amen. So, how do we respond? Well, there's a few questions that I want to put to you today. First of all, are there times when a Christian taking up arms is justified? Are there times that there is appropriateness to having a just war? What steps can I take to be a peacemaker? Are there areas where I still struggle with wanting to exercise my power over others to get my own way? And how might Jesus want me to seek shalom? There's going to be some music played, and as that music played, I invite you to take some time to pull up those response cards, and we'll respond to those. And then after the music's played for a little bit, I'll lead us in a time of communion as we start to wrap up our time together today. God bless you.